Binary search is one of the most popular and widely used algorithms that universities teach in their courses. It's also very practical in several real-world applications. It's used to search for data in large collections, find solutions to optimization problems, and even sometimes in machine learning to perform efficient hyperparameter tuning. Imagine you have a large list of numbers stored in increasing order. Now you get another query number, and you should tell the position of that number in the list as fast as possible. One might go over the list element by element and return the index as soon as the query number is found. But even if that approach would work fine for small collections, it would be really slow for large lists of numbers. Instead, because we know that the initial array is sorted, we can split the array into two equal parts and throw away the one that we know doesn't contain the query number. So we will look at the middle element of the array and compare it to the query number. If the middle element is smaller than the query number, we will throw away the whole left part of the array, as we know for sure the element we're searching for can't be in the left part of the array. We will then compare the query number to the middle element of the remaining array. If the middle element is larger than the query number, we will throw away the whole right part of the array, as we know for sure the element we're searching for can't be there. We continue that process until there is only a single element left in the array. That way, we will find the element we were searching for. So what we just did here is the binary search algorithm. The core idea behind the binary search algorithm is the realization that we can split the search space on every iteration and throw away the part that we know for sure cannot contain what we're looking for. Now imagine that instead of having a few elements in the list, there were many more. Imagine there were 10 billion elements instead. If we would loop through all the elements from first to last trying to find the query number, we would perform 10 billion operations in the worst case. But with binary search, we're able to halve the search space on each iteration. So with a single operation, we would get from 10 billion to 5 billion elements, then with one more operation to 2.5 billion elements, and so on. In the end, instead of performing 10 billion operations, we would just perform 32. To make a real-life comparison, imagine that comparing an array element to our query number takes 1 second. That way, if we loop through the whole array and perform 10 billion operations, it would take about 317 years to complete the search. But with binary search, it would be just 32 seconds. And that's a huge difference in speed. Now, what if we double the array? What if we add another 10 billion elements to the array, making it 20 billion? Well, in that case, the linear search would take us 634 years to complete, while the binary search would just add a single operation, just 1 second. Making it 33 seconds in total. So having n elements in the initial array, what would be the time complexities for the linear and binary search algorithms? Well, as we iterate over all the numbers when performing the linear search, we would perform all of n operations in total. On the other hand, as we halve the number of elements we need to consider on each iteration, the time complexity for the binary search becomes O of log n. Let's see how we can implement the binary search algorithm and make the implementation as elegant as possible. There are many different approaches when it comes to implementing binary search. All of the approaches store two different values that indicate the segment of the array that's currently being looked at. Many people prefer to make both endpoints inclusive, so the left endpoint is initially 0 and the right endpoint is the length of the array minus 1. But that makes some computations a bit tedious. In terms of implementing the algorithm, it's much more elegant to make the left endpoint inclusive and the right one exclusive. So the left endpoint can technically be the final answer, while the right one can't. We will soon see why this makes the computations more straightforward. So when initializing, we will set the left endpoint to be 0 and the right one to be the array length. After that, we will start splitting the search space in half and discard the unnecessary parts. So while there is at least one element in between L and R to consider, we will continue looping. We will take the midpoint index and round it down in case the sum of left and right is odd, after which we will compare if the middle element is larger than the query number. If it is, we will throw away the whole right part of the array and assign R to mid. Notice how we assign R to mid, as R is exclusive and we just saw that mid cannot be part of the answer as the element is larger than the query. We can assign R to mid. If both L and R endpoints were inclusive, we would need to set R to mid minus 1 instead. Otherwise, if the middle element is smaller than or equal to the query number, we set L to be equal to mid. Notice again that if L and R were both inclusive, we would have to do another check to see if the middle element was equal to the query number and set L to mid plus 1 if it wasn't. If we did that, we would need to modify the condition for the while loop as well to check if R is greater than or equal to L. So that would add a lot of boilerplate code, which we can avoid by thinking of the ranges as one endpoint being inclusive, while the other one being exclusive. Finally, when there are no elements between L and R that we can consider, the final answer is going to be the element at index L if it's equal to the query number. If it isn't, we can print -1 to indicate that the query number wasn't found in the array. Let's run the algorithm and see how it works on a specific example. Given this array, let's see how we would find the number 49. First, we would initialize L to 0 and R to 9, after which we will enter the while loop and would calculate the mid to be 0 plus 9 divided by 2, which would be 4.5, so we will round it down to 4. After that, we will check if 34 is larger than 49. As it's not larger, we will enter the else block and set L to 4. That way, the search space would be reduced to only the right part of the array. After that, we will go back to the start of the while loop, as there are still elements in between L and R, meaning R minus L is equal to 5, which is greater than 1, we will enter the loop. We will calculate the mid and set its value to be 4 plus 9 divided by 2. That would be 6.5, which we will round down to 6. After that, we will check if 52 is larger than 49, and as it's larger, we will set R to 6. We will then go back to check the condition of the while loop. As R minus L is equal to 2, we will enter the loop again. The value of mid now will be 4 plus 6 divided by 2, which would be equal to 5. We will check if 49 is greater than 49. As it's not greater, we will enter the else block and set the value of L to 5. Going back to check the condition of the while loop, we can see that R minus L is now 1, meaning there are no more elements in between the two endpoints that we haven't considered. So we will break the loop, and because the element at index 5 is equal to 49, we will print 5. Now let's consider an edge case where we're searching for a value that's not in the array. How would our implementation work in that case? Let's take the same array but search for the value 57 instead. The value of L and R would be initialized to 0 and 9 like before, and after that we will enter the while loop. The mid would be 0 plus 9 divided by 2, which rounded down would be 4. After that we will check if 34 is greater than 57. As it's not, we will throw away the left part of the array by entering the else block and setting the value of L to 4. Going back to the start of the loop, we will calculate the value of mid and we'll get 4 plus 9 divided by 2, which is 6. We will check if 52 is larger than 57, and as it's not, we will throw away the left part again by setting the value of L to 6. In the next step, we will calculate the value of mid and we'll get 6 plus 9 divided by 2, which would be 7. We will check if 55 is greater than 57. As is not, we will enter the else block and set the value of L to 7. Going forward, we will calculate the value of mid again and we will get 7 plus 9 divided by 2, which is 8. We will check if 58 is larger than 57. As it is larger, we will set R to 8. As now the value of L is 7 and the value of R is 8, their difference is equal to 1 and we can stop the loop. After comparing the value at position L to the query number, we will see that their values don't match and the array actually doesn't contain the desired number. Now, as a practical exercise, try pausing the video and write down all the steps of the algorithm when searching for different values like 20, 23 or 100 using pen and paper. That will really help in understanding how the algorithm works. Did you know that a 1988 study found that 3 out of 4 computer science textbooks contained a wrong implementation of the binary search algorithm and had different bugs? It's actually not that trivial to implement the binary search algorithm correctly. And even the standard library of Java contained the wrong implementation and had a bug in there that wasn't fixed for 9 years. The bug had to do with how integers are handled in languages like Java or C++. A standard integer occupies 4 bytes and can hold values from about minus 2 billion to 2 billion. Now, if we look at the implementation of the binary search, we can notice that when calculating the midpoint index, we add L and R together and then divide the sum by 2. But what if the value of L is 1.5 billion while the value of R is 1.7 billion? Well, in that case, the computer would try to add those two integers together and try to store the result in 4 bytes. But because the sum is larger than 2 billion, the value would actually overflow and go beyond those 4 bytes, causing the result to be some negative number. That would crash the whole algorithm. To avoid that, a better implementation would be to add to L half of the distance between L and R. So the calculation would become L plus R minus L divided by 2, which would not overflow for large numbers. And in our case, that would correctly result in 1.6 billion. Actually, the initial implementation would work totally fine with languages like Python, where the integers are not limited to 4 bytes. But for languages like Java or C++, the code would occasionally crash, making it very hard to detect and fix. Now having this amazing binary search algorithm to find elements in large collections that's so efficient and so elegant, it would make sense to use it every time we try to search for something in an array, right? Well, wrong. Even though the binary search algorithm is very useful, there are some cases where not using it can be a better choice. Especially for low-level languages like C or C++, there might be cases when we're searching in a small collection, and in that case, performing a linear search might be a better choice and faster compared to the binary search. That's because our computers can do low-level optimizations when loading consecutive memory chunks, as well as do branch prediction, which significantly speeds up the loop. Another scenario is the case where the initial array is not sorted. And in that case, we can first sort the array and then perform binary search, but that would only make sense if there are way more queries than the number of operations required to sort the array. And to sort the array of numbers in increasing order, we would need to perform all of n log n operations. So if there is only a single query number that we need to search for, we would be better off performing just a linear search, which would take all of n operations. But if there are more than log n queries, it can make sense to first sort the array and then perform binary search for each query after that. In general, it's best to think of the binary search algorithm as a fundamental generic idea instead of a fixed implementation, where we split the problem on every iteration and throw away the unnecessary part. Having that understanding, you already have a solid background on the classic use case for binary search. However, there are many more problems that can be solved by modifying the initial technique a little bit. For instance, you might want to apply binary search on floating point numbers to find the square root of a given number with a certain precision without using the SQRT function. Or you might want to make the right endpoint inclusive while leaving the left endpoint exclusive. To go deeper and really master binary search, head to Profound Academy and try your hand at different practical problems. I'll leave the link in the description below. And don't forget to like this video if you found it helpful. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.